All right, so the state poll results are out, and there's a very clear picture that's emerging. It's Jayalalitha and Mamata Banerjee that are striding back to power, both incumbents being voted back in the Assam, and that's such a sweep for the BJP. There should be music to the ears of the central government here, and Kerala is where the Congress has lost to the left. So if actually you ask me, there are five big takeaways, and we're going to discuss just that with Rajeev Chandrasekhar and Sagarika Ghosh, who are joining us right here on ET Now. The first is emergence of BJP as the truly only national party right now. How it does this embolden the reform process, even though it doesn't really change a lot of numbers in the Rajya Sabha. The Congress and the complete decimation of the Congress and what it does for UP and also for Punjab. And of course, more than anything else, the regional satraps, how powerful they be and the clout that they will have. Thank you both of you for joining us. Rajeev, to you then. Is BJP perhaps the only truly national party now, an inroad into a state like Kerala, which was such a Congress and a left bastion, and on its way to form the next government in Assam?
Yeah, I think it's obvious that the BJP NDA is the only formation, political formation, that is consistently expanding both vote share and footprint around the country. And on the other hand, the party that has been at the forefront of reasonable amount of obstruction in parliament for the last year and a half, which is the Congress, is increasingly showing signs that it is becoming irrelevant, even in a state like Kerala, where it will go from being 39 seats in the assembly to about 20-21 seats. So I think the facts are all out there for people to see, that the politics of negativity and obstructionism that the Congress played out for the last several months has given it exactly what it has got today, which is nothing.
All right, so the politics of obstruction and opposition that the Congress has played has perhaps resulted in the verdict that it has. Sagarika, do you essentially agree with that analysis? Is this the complete decimation of the Congress party? Are we extrapolating the state results too much? Is BJP today the only national party, a space that Congress has put to BJP on a platter, it seems, right now?
Very right, Supriya. As we've been discussing since the morning, I think the picture is clear. The Congress is in terminal decline from these results, it would appear, and the BJP is growing nationally. There's a lot to worry about for the Congress party. A very important breakthrough has been made by the BJP in Assam. It just shows how effective their electioneering has been in Assam. Of course, the RSS has worked on the ground for years. Of course, the Sangh Parivar units have worked on the ground for years, but the BJP learnt its lessons from Bihar and Delhi and actually played a different kind of politics in Assam, and that has won them very rich dividends. I would also like to point out, you have been exploring the issue of relationships between the regional satraps and the central government. You see, if you look at it, the Congress is now so irrelevant in Tamil Nadu. In terms of the seats, it's not even the B team. You see, since 1989, the Congress has, it's been a yo-yo between AIA, DMK and DMK, but the Congress has been kingmaker. Whichever alliance it has gone with, whichever party it has gone with, has won. Now, even that is broken. So if the Congress is not even a valuable ally in Tamil Nadu, that means that with the growth of the BJP could supplant the Congress as a valuable ally at the state level. And that would significantly alter the dynamics between the state government and the central government, because if the BJP is going to become a valuable potential ally in the state, then naturally the relationship between the state and the central government and the ruling BJP will become much closer. So it really is good news for the BJP in Tamil Nadu in that way, and terrible news for the Congress even as a potential ally there. So, at the end of the day, it really is bad news for the Congress. But at the end of the day, I think we also need to make the point of the sheer variety of the electoral result we've seen. The left has won, the BJP has won, Jayalalitha is on the winning streak, Mamata has won. So a very varied picture, and I think we can draw comfort of Indian democracy from that.
Oh, absolutely. And the dance of democracy, the comfort that it gives some of us here. But Rajeev, I want to come to you because I think our investors, our constituents, our viewers, our investors, they would want to know what does all of this add up to as far as national politics is concerned? The BJP making a stunning inroad in Northeast, making an inroad in Kerala, winning on its way to winning 10 seats in Bengal, leading in three as far as Tamil Nadu is concerned. And like Sagarika was pointing out there, the whole regional map unfolding for the BJP. What does this do for the reform process? Does this embolden the government further? I know it doesn't change numbers in the Rajya Sabha, but what does it do to economic legislations?
No. Look, I mean, if I was an investor sitting thousands of miles away and trying to understand what was going on for the last 1 year, 1.5 years, and this deadlock and this stalemate in Parliament, this is a very welcome set of results, because it clearly signals to me that the government that is in Delhi, the government that is the government of India, enjoys a large degree of popular support. And that is what is required as a catalyst and a trigger for the government to move forward with its reforms, move forward with deeper structural reforms. There was a period in the last 4 or 5 months when all of this obstructionism of the Congress fed a perception that maybe the government in Delhi was becoming less than popular compared to, let's say, 2014. And so this is a very important reaffirmation of the popular mandate that the Narendra Modi government has. And that will, in my opinion, without a doubt, signal very positively to investors, very positively to the government itself, that it can confidently move down the road of reforms and change that it was elected to in 2014. So I think this has got more implications for the directional cues for our economy and our country than just simply having four elections and the demise of the Congress.
That's exactly the point, isn't it? The demise of the Congress and the cues that it does throw up for Indian economy. But let me just stay with you, because you are a Rajya Sabha member. You've seen how the GST has been thrown from the Treasury to the opposition benches, how it is really caught in a political crossfire of sorts. Does this election result of four states, one union territory, blunt the political legitimacy of the Congress to today oppose the GST? Something that India is ready for, something that the government is pushing. Yes, they opposed it while they were in the opposition benches, but today they want to champion it. Does this blunt the political legitimacy of the Congress to continue opposing the GST, and do you actually expect it to become a reality going forward?
It not just blunts it, it raises a complete question mark about the Congress's political strategy in Parliament, because it clearly is not achieving anything for anybody. The least that a political party can do for itself by doing something in Parliament is get itself votes. It does not do that. It loses all its elections, and it puts the country behind as well as in terms of reforms. It puts the average citizen on the disadvantage. So I think the Congress's strategy over the last 1 year in a lot of ways has proved to be a failure for its own political needs. And we all know that it doesn't help the economy, it doesn't help the average citizen. So I think it's time for the Congress to sit back, take a pause and say this kind of obstructive politics for the sake of obstruction isn't helping them, and it is also hurting the country. And so they may want a plan B, and I don't know what that plan B is, but as a start, I would recommend to them that you should stop obstructing good legislations like GST and the other bills that are in the pipeline.
You hold your thoughts there, because I have a question for you coming your way in just a moment from now as far as allies are concerned and the changing dynamics in New Delhi. But Sagarika, my question to you is, and already I've seen people begin to discuss, is there an imminent breakup of the Congress party that we are staring at? What is its plan B? To get Priyanka Gandhi to revive the fortunes of the Congress party? They keep talking about it, but it hasn't happened, and she alone cannot instill any life in a party which seems to be lifeless. It hardly has, like Swami was pointing out earlier in the day today, volunteers to campaign for this. I mean, are we looking at an imminent breakup of the Congress party?
I think the Congress party, as we said earlier, is in terminal decline. And as Mr. Chandrasekhar is rightly pointing out, I think the vote banks are melting away from the Congress. I think the Tea Garden workers in Assam, the Christian Church in Kerala. These have all clearly in the past voiced that they are no longer completely loyal to the Congress. Even in Assam, you know, Mr. Gogoi was counting on the minority vote bank, on a solid minority vote bank coming automatically to the Congress. Even that has not happened. In fact, the minority vote bank, the Muslim vote bank, which the Congress relies on, has split in Assam. And I think the old style vote bank politics that the Congress is used to playing, it has come unstuck both in Kerala and in Assam. In that sense, I think the Congress will have to go in for a serious reboot. It's taking some consolation from the fact that it's won MCD elections. It's won a couple of, had a few gains in the MCD elections in Delhi. And perhaps that's the pointer. Go back to the drawing board, go back to the ground, build from the soil. The fact is, when I traveled in Tamil Nadu, I saw a certain hunger in the BJP cadres there that the Congress simply did not have. The BJP was pouring in its resources, pouring in its energy. It was fighting the election. The Congress was simply sitting back and being lackluster. I think that hunger is missing. And unless that hunger comes back, I don't see the Congress being able to reboot. But a lesson also for the BJP, Supriya, as we've been speaking since the morning, the BJP in Assam has not emphasized any kind of extremist Hindutva position. It has not gone with communal rhetoric. In fact, it's gone with a local leader and with development and infrastructure as its rhetoric. I think that's what the BJP needs to learn from and push on the economic front in Delhi. And I think the voices, the discordant voices of social disorder that are heard, I think those are not to be emphasized. This result is showing there are really no takers for that. I think it's the economic message that voters are, message that the government needs to push in Delhi, because that's the message that's getting the votes.
Oh, absolutely. And it was the development card that did win them 2014, did it not? Rajeev Chandrasekhar, before I let you go and then join you next in just a while from now, but my question is, a lot of people believe at the central level, the BJP hasn't reached out to potential allies, a Jayalalitha, a Mamata Banerjee, who could have perhaps supported a lot of legislation. Do you believe those dynamics will change after these results? Both Mamata and Jaya are coming back to power and coming back with better, bigger numbers.
No, I am hopeful of that. I can't say I'm confident of that because I'm not in government, but I'm very hopeful that there is clearly an alignment now of parties that believe in what in the legislations that are good for the nation, good for the economy, good in, for creating jobs. It the only thing that was discordant all these months was this constant carping and noise and obstruction by the Congress. And I hope genuinely, and I really, you know, would pray that they abandon that line of obstructive politics, get into, you know, whatever it is that they believe in, have, you know, much more practical, pragmatic debates in parliament, change bills, change laws, whatever it is. But this obstruction, this noise in parliament was creating all kinds of fallouts, not just, you know, within the parliament, outside the parliament, and uncertainty that was really hurting us, has hurt us for the last 6-7 months. So I hope that they reconsider their political game plan and, you know, believe that they can get votes by a new narrative, you know, maybe an alternate set of ideas to the government, rather than just saying everything that the government does is wrong.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you very much, Rajeev and Sagrika Dohr, for joining us on this leg of the discussions on state assembly elections and what do they mean for Indian politics and Indian economy at large. We'll hand it over to Avan to take it forward as far as market action is concerned. See you next time, Sagrika.
Thank you so much, Supriya, for walking us through that fairly interesting discussion there on the state.